AN fittings and flexible braided hose are somewhat a staple of motorsport plumbing. We're here with Jamie at Raceworks to take a deeper look into plumbing for performance applications. So starting with that term, AN fittings, it's commonly thrown around but maybe less commonly understood. Can you just explain what that term means?
AN is a, it dates back to World War II. It actually stands for Army Navy from the US military. It was a joint agreement between the US Army and Navy, and it's a set of standards essentially. So it's not a common measurement like a metric or imperial measurement. It's a set of standards, and those standards basically determine hose internal diameter, hardline external diameter, thread of fittings, and also the way those fittings connect, which is via a flare, which is a 37 degree flare. So it's a metal on metal contact. There's no sealant, there's no gasket, there's no O-ring, nothing like that. But essentially that's what AN is.
Yeah, so the fitting itself is the flare fitting is where it seals. That's the sealing surface. The threads are the other important thing, I guess. And that's kind of like the similar thing that people say is a JIC style thread. But I think the tolerances are a bit different for the AN fitting.
Yeah, the actual specification is slightly different between JIC and AN. They are very similar though, yep.
Right, so just moving on to the hoses that we discussed, braided hose. There's a few variations there internally, and can we just discuss what those kind of main ones are?
Yeah, of course. So there's braid over rubber, very common, very flexible. Because of its flexibility, it's often used on larger hoses. So if you ever see a dry sump system, or even water radiator, something like that, it's always braid over rubber, because the other style being braid over PTFE, which we'll go into in a sec, it just isn't flexible enough for that application. So you start with your braid over rubber, and then you move to braid over PTFE, which stands for polytetrafluoroethylene. It's similar to a plastic, but it handles almost anything you can throw it at. You could basically put acid inside PTFE and it still won't break down.
Also kind of known as Teflon, but I think that's more of a brand name for PTFE, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's a trademark brand name. But the actual product is PTFE, yeah.
So you discussed the use of the braided rubber hose for oil lines and coolant lines. Where would you use PTFE?
You can use it for oil and coolant as well. As well as a braid over rubber, you can use it for fuel. PTFE will withstand a higher pressure and temperature. So if you ever see a power steering system, it's usually with a flexible line, it's usually PTFE. Whereas braid over rubber just will not handle on the high pressure side of a power steering system that much pressure.
And with certain types of fuels, ethanol, things like that, is there an issue with the normal rubber hoses where PTFE would need to be used?
Look, PTFE, a lot of people feel, is more reliable when using exotic fuels and things like that are untested in certain rubbers. Generally, with any fuel available at the bowser, you'll never have a problem with a braid over rubber hose. With other exotic fuels and additives, obviously, we can't guarantee its use. But with your common fuels, you never have a problem.
Yeah, right. And just moving on to the fittings, the hose ends that connect them, we discussed the AN fitting size, but the actual hose used with hose end used with flexible hose. There's a few different variations there. Three kind of spring to mind. Can you cover what those are?
Yeah, so there's the braid over rubber, which we mentioned, braid over PTFE, and then what's known as push lock, which is essentially just a rubber hose, but it uses a special connection on the fitting whereby you can push it on, but you can't pull it off. And it will not pull off up to a certain pressure or temperature. So they're probably the easiest to assemble, easier than a braided hose. However, they will not handle as high a temperature or pressure as a braided hose will.
And they need to be used with something like a hose clamp or a hose finisher, which is kind of a fancy hose clamp to secure the hose to the push lock?
At a lower pressure, push lock actually doesn't require any clamp. It's unbelievably easy to use. At a higher pressure or a higher temperature, a clamp's definitely a good idea. Just want to ensure you don't tighten that clamp too much, because the push lock barb inside that hose is actually quite aggressive and it will cut the inside of the hose if you crank on an outer clamp.
And so the other style, well, that used with the overbraid hose, we have reusable hose ends and also crimp hose ends. can we just maybe cover reusable hose ends first? They're probably the most commonly used for kind of DIY applications.
Yeah, so braid over rubber hose is a reusable hose end. There is nothing that ever gets thrown in the bin. You can literally undo it, provided you don't damage it, and do it back up on another hose. A PTFE hose end has a compression olive inside, which is one-time use. So if you ever want to reuse that hose end, you simply insert a new olive into it.
Okay. And the crimp style hose end, we hear it at World Time Attack, and a lot of the cars that we see in the pits are using the crimp style hose end as opposed to a reusable one. What would be the reason for that?
It's to do with weight generally. A crimp hose end is more compact. There's less to it and it's extremely light.
And would the security of that be also increased?
In OE applications, certainly in like braking systems and things like that, they require crimped hose ends and they're tested to very high pressures. In a DIY hose or a reusable hose, you would argue that a crimped connection would be better than a screw together connection. But in reality, there's so many race cars out there using DIY hoses that work all day, every day successfully.
So the main benefit really is the weight and it's more compact. With the hoses and as well, like PTFE versus a rubber overbraid hose, is there a difference in weight there?
PTFE is lighter, yeah. So it's lighter and it's smaller in diameter. So the line is actually very thin compared to a rubber hose that's thicker in the wall. So it's more compact. The downside with PTFE is you just can't bend it as tight without it kinking.
That makes a lot of sense. So I will just move on a little bit to hard lines. The smaller diameter hard lines, we can use fittings similar to like a reusable hose end, but that's more like the PTFE style with multiple pieces, is that right?
Yeah, so similar to a PTFE hose end, it also uses a compression olive, which is a snug fit over the hard line, and provided that olive is a 100% snug fit, you can use that reusable adapter on the end of the hard line. And it's the same for aluminium, hardline, steel, stainless, all the same. They can use the same adapters. The other option with hardline is you can flare it with a flare tool, as provided you got 37 degree dies, which we sell. And then you simply use a tube nut and a sleeve.
So on the larger end of the plumbing spectrum, we have our intercooler piping, large diameter, usually aluminium. Tubing. In most kind of lower level aftermarket applications, silicone couplers are used, but is there any limitation to that?
Oh, look, there will be a boost pressure limit that silicone can take. In saying that, if your tube or your intercooler or whatever it might be has a good solid bead rolled on it, silicone can actually handle quite a high pressure. For those that want some increased reliability in a high horsepower or high boost environment, these days they use clamshell couplings, or the original design of those was called the Adel Wiggins clamp, and they're all, I guess, a copy or an evolution of that.
Yeah, so the kind of architecture of that clamp, you have a ferrule on each side and then a clamshell clamping them together?
Yeah, that's right, and it seals with O-rings.
So is there a general kind of rule of boost pressure where you might look to move to that clamshell style pipe clamp over a silicone coupler?
Look, everyone has a different opinion on that. The other advantage with clamshells is they're cosmetically quite good looking. We've had customers with silicone hoses with, you know, 60 pound of boost, never an issue, running them for years in motorsport environments. So, but whereas other people claim they have issues at much lower boost levels, but again, it comes back to how well that bead is rolled and that securing surface.
So just to cover what that bead is specifically and how that is rolled and the purpose of it, can you just comment on that?
Essentially, it's like almost like a flare on the end of the tube, which just gives the clamp, the hose clamp, something to grab onto and stop the silicone hose from pulling off.
And methods of actually creating that bead, I've seen some kind of ones with people just working around with a plier forming it, but I saw you actually have a tool to do that.
Yeah, that's very agricultural. I've seen people go around and weld a bead as well, but the best way to do it is with a bead rolling tool, commonly used for aluminium, maybe used for other materials, stainless or steel as well.
And I guess in an industrial situation, there's a thing called ram forging that can forge that as well. But the other benefit of having that bead roll is to increase the integrity of the end of the pipe, because installing hose clamps too tight, like you discussed earlier with the push-on fittings, can damage the pipe.
there are people that go nuts with hose clamps and tightening them up, thinking that that is their problem and that's what's going to hold their hose on. In reality, you can, like, there are people that use worm drive clamps successfully, provided you have a really nice solid bead and the right size clamp for the application. They'll actually work to quite a high pressure.
And just another thing I wanted to discuss, having your radiator or intercooler is fixed to the chassis in most situations, and you're plumbing that to your engine, which moves with torque and vibration, things like that, you're going to require some type of flexibility between the two. Flexible silicone coupler, it's understandable to see how that would provide that. Those clamshell pipe clamps, do they also provide that flexibility?
It's less flexibility than a silicone hose. There is still movement inside those clamps. They are designed that way. So they basically, they seal on O-rings, but they are designed to, the ferrules are designed to be able to move inside the clamp.
So something to maybe consider if you have an older vehicle with softer engine mounts compared to a motorsport vehicle where there'd be less movement?
Yeah, they're more so designed for a vehicle with a stiff mount or a solid mount.
That's a good consideration to take into mind. Just moving to the sizings of things, we'll just jump back to the flexible hoses. So we discussed the internal diameter of those at the start and the external diameter of the hard lines. The dash sizing, what does that all mean? What does it relate to? It can be kind of hard to get your head around if you're not used to it. It's not a standard way of measuring something.
Yeah, so the terminology that's commonly used for AN fittings are, they're referred to as dash fittings. And that is basically their size might be, let's say, AN-6, for example, or AN-8. If we're talking rubber hose and rubber hose only, the easy way to do a mental calculation is simply divide its dash number by 16. So if it's a -8 hose, it's going to have an ID of 0.5 inch. Or if it's a -6 hose, it's going to have an ID of 3/8 inch. Now, originally, with the AN standard, all hose and fittings, it worked that way. But when they went to braided hose, the actual standard or the measurements of the internal diameter of those hoses changed a little bit. And you'll find on a braided hose, it's a little bit smaller internally than a rubber hose is.
So would you recommend with that if you're purchasing fittings, you also purchase the hose with that from a supplier so you're sure that they're designed for the same size?
Yeah, absolutely. So you need to be sure that that hose and hose end is going to work properly together. You can mix a hose end with an adapter, say, from different manufacturers if you wish, but it's important to ensure the hose end and the hose is from the same manufacturer.
Yeah, perfect. That's going to get the best fit and remove any chance of leakage and things like that.
Yeah, and failure, absolutely.
Cool. Well, if anyone wants to check out your products, follow along with what your new products you're developing, where can they do so?
So we're based in Australia. Our website's raceworks.com.au. There's a dealer map on there. We currently only sell within Australia. We do have dealers at export. We're looking to actually head over to New Zealand pretty soon, so that's exciting. But for now, we're just in Australia.
Cool. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.